Supersonic passenger travel, a fabled dream of aerospace engineers until one day.
Mach 0.8, Mach 0.9.
We did it.
Ladies and gentlemen, we just broke the speed of sound.
All the way back in the 70s, but fast forward to today, and no matter how much money you have, you can't go faster than the speed of sound. So what happened? Why hasn't it taken off? And why might the next decade finally bring back the race for supersonic flight? The history is fascinating, and the future maybe even more so. So let's see if we can't figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit DaVinci.
This video is sponsored by Lifen.
Most people don't know this, but Concorde wasn't the first supersonic jetliner. No, that was the Russian Tupolev 144. It was a hot summer day in Moscow in 1962 when the phone rang in the Tupolev design bureau. It's Soviet leader Nikita Khrushchev, and he sounds angry. The UK and France just joined forces to build the world's first commercial supersonic jet. It was the height of the Cold War. Russia had already beaten the West by placing the first satellite in orbit on October 4th, 1957, and had also put the first man in space only 2 weeks before the US sent Alan Shepard in 1961. Russia wanted to continue the winning streak, and they did. Russia's Tupolev 144 performs its maiden flight on a cold and cloudy day in Moscow on December 31st, 1968, beating the West to supersonic travel. It would take Concorde another 3 months to take to the skies for the first time. The sleek, white aircraft, nicknamed the Concordsky by the Western media, was a symbol of Soviet pride and technological prowess. It was a result of an almost decade-long race against the rival Concorde. The flight landed in Alma-Ata, the then capital of Kazakhstan, covering a distance of 2,200 kilometers. The pilot, Mikhail Kozlov, was greeted with cheers and applause and hailed a hero. Meanwhile in Paris, the Concorde team was watching the news with a mix of envy and disappointment. They had been working on their own supersonic jet since 1954 and joined forces with the British to spread the cost and risk of the development process. The Concorde was more advanced and elegant than the Tupolev 144, but also more expensive and complex. It had a distinctive delta wing design, a variable geometry nose, and a sophisticated engine system. It was also quieter and more fuel efficient than the Tu-144, but required longer runways and more maintenance. The Concorde made its maiden flight in March 1969 and hit supersonic speed for the first time in October 1969, but it was still not ready for commercial service. The race for the skies wasn't over. Both the Tu-144 and the Concorde faced many obstacles and setbacks in the following years. Tupolev 144 suffered from reliability and safety issues and was involved in several accidents, the worst of which was a fatal crash at the 1963 Paris Air Show, which killed 6 crew members and 8 people on the ground. Witnesses claimed the pilot had been bragging in front of the Air France pilots. When he took off, he did a dangerous maneuver that made the plane stall and hit the thrusters. The plane's structure couldn't hold the stress and broke apart into pieces in midair. The Paris Air Show crash set the Tupolev 144 back several years, entering commercial service only in 1977. The Concorde beat them to that mark by 1 year. Compared to the Tupolev 144, the Concorde was a resounding success. Designed and built by Soud Aviation and the British Aircraft Corporation, it went supersonic for the first time in October 1969. The British Airways fleet alone flew almost 50,000 flights carrying over 2.5 million people across the Atlantic and other routes. Since the cabins held 92 to 128 first-class seats, that means that each Concorde flew on average at about 50% capacity. And there are several theories around this. Most people claim that Concorde was a money pit for British Airways and Air France, but I don't think that was the case, at least not at first.
Actually, hold on 1 sec. This is the Life and Wave toothbrush, our sponsor this week and maybe my favorite product so far in 2024. Its single-piece handle is manufactured more like a flagship smartphone than a toothbrush. It vibrates at 66,000 times a minute, and while other sonic toothbrushes do that, the Wave also oscillates up to 60 degrees, and unlike my old toothbrush, it can all be adjusted. I personally like higher vibration strength, wide oscillation range, but slower oscillation speed. And using the smartphone app, I have it saved as a custom mode for myself. It has dual lithium-ion batteries and up to 30 days of battery life. and check out how much smaller it is than my old toothbrush. The motors are up to 3 times more powerful than other brushes, so the brush does all the work for you so you don't have to press as hard, which is way better for your gums. In fact, Wave comes in 3 different finishes and with 3 different brush heads, Gum Care, Ultra Whitening, and Super Clean. And replacement heads are an incredible value with a 6-pack coming in around $16.99, and it charges via magnetic cable and USB-C. They've really thought of everything. I take oral hygiene seriously, and I haven't had a cavity in decades. And now I'm teaching my boys, and so far they too are cavity free. This is the best toothbrush I've ever used, and I think you'll love it too. Check out the brilliant Life and Wave toothbrush using my links in the description to save 10% today. Huge thanks to Life and you. Now back to the show. I wanted to figure out if the plane was profitable. I mean, it did serve for decades, so it couldn't have been losing money the whole time, right? The argument is that the Concorde was horribly inefficient, even compared to the 747 jumbo jet. Fuel efficiency was horrible. For every 1 gallon of fuel Concorde burned, it could only carry each passenger 17 miles. For comparison, the Boeing 777 pulls 80 passenger miles per gallon. Since the round trip from New York to London is about 7,000 miles, that means when flying at full capacity, Concorde cost British Airways $520 per passenger in today's money. $1,040 if the plane traveled half full. That does seem like a lot, but here's the kicker. Each round trip ticket cost a whopping $14,700. For comparison, a first class round trip ticket on board a British Airways 777 today would cost around $4,000, yet the fuel cost per passenger is almost the same, around $5.25 when full, because of the higher fuel prices of the day. But fuel isn't everything. How about maintenance for a supersonic aircraft? Yes, that's got to be higher too, but you are making $14,000 per passenger per flight. Another important factor was safety. In 1989, a Concorde lost half of its rudder over the Tasman Sea, but landed safely. It happened again in 1992. On July 24th, 2000, British Airways said it had detected cracks in the wings of its 7 Concordes, causing one plane to be grounded. The very next day, disaster struck in Paris. On July 25th, 2000, a piece of debris ruptured one of the tires of the Concorde Air France Flight 4590 as it was taken off from the Charles de Gaulle Airport. It punctured the plane's fuel tank and it caught fire, ultimately crash landing and killing everyone on board. 113 people died in that crash, and the fleet was grounded for the next year. Concorde returns to service with transatlantic flights resuming from London and Paris on November 2001, but things aren't the same. The dot-com crash and 9/11 combined to dramatically reduce the demand for supersonic travel. Also, other subsonic jetliners were proving to be way more profitable than the outdated Concorde. With only 14 ever built, it must have been hellish trying to find spare parts for maintenance. But one challenge above all else put the nail in the coffin for the Concorde and the Tupolev 144, and that was noise. No, not noise inside the cabin like in the Concordeski, but the deafening roar of the sonic boom people on the ground experienced every time a Concorde flew overhead and broke the speed of sound. The sonic boom was as loud as operating a chainsaw in your hands. Only a couple years after its first commercial flight, the FAA realized how much of a problem sonic booms were, like breaking glass on homes. And so in 1971, Congress banned civil supersonic travel over land. This restricted the Concorde to serve only transoceanic routes, and these routes could hardly provide the demand for first-class tickets to keep the Concorde operational. And just like that, the dream of supersonic travel seemed to fade away. One of my great regrets is that I was too young and too broke to have flown on one of these airplanes. If I could hop on a Concorde today for $14,000, I would do it, and I probably wouldn't be alone. But the good news is, supersonic travel wasn't forgotten. In the 21st century, a new wave of innovators and entrepreneurs emerged, determined to revive supersonic travel. Surely, like all great engineers, they were inspired by the achievements and lessons learned from the Tupolev 144 and the Concorde, and aimed to overcome their limitations. The key goal then? Make a supersonic aircraft that travels quieter than ever before to control the sonic boom. This really got me thinking, is that even possible? I mean, we're talking about physics now, not just software or compute power. Could we really engineer our way out of a sonic boom, or at least bring them down
to a tolerable level. These companies are using new technologies and materials such as carbon fiber, titanium, and composite alloys to create lighter and stronger aircraft. They also develop new engine designs and aerodynamic features such as variable cycle engines, laminar flow wings, and bottomless crews to reduce noise and emissions. But that's not all. They also focused on creating more affordable and accessible supersonic services, targeting not only elite business travelers, but leisure travelers as well, which would solve the demand issue. Among these new supersonic players, we find Boom Supersonic, a US-based startup that plans to launch its full-length 55-seat Overture jet by 2029, capable of flying at Mach 2.2 and connecting over 500 destinations worldwide. Boom's success relies on lifting the ban on supersonic travel over land to access a wider market. Another company making the news is Aireon, another US-based company that partnered with Airbus and Boeing to develop its 12-seat AS2 jet, which should fly at Mach 1.4 and use existing airports and airspace. Another example is Spike Aerospace, a US-based firm that aimed to introduce its 18-seat S512 jet, which will fly at Mach 1.6 and feature a windowless cabin with panoramic screens. And most ambitiously, there's Hermes, a US-based venture that envisions a 20-seat hypersonic jet, which would fly at Mach 5 and cross the Atlantic in just 90 minutes. And as a person who's about to fly halfway around the world, I'd say sign me up. But perhaps the most promising supersonic project right now that's actually pretty close to flying is the X-59. This is a prototype developed by NASA in collaboration with Lockheed Martin. Also known as the X-59 Quest for quiet supersonic technology, it was designed to demonstrate the feasibility of a low-boom supersonic flight, which would avoid the loud sonic boom that plagued the Tupolev 144 and Concorde and caused public annoyance and regulatory restriction. It can fly a Mach 1.4, and it's supposed to produce a sonic boom as soft as a car door closing. Lockheed Martin released a video showing an assembled X-59 rolling out of a hangar on August 4th, 2023, and its first flight is planned for 2024. How exciting is that? If NASA and Lockheed Martin pull this off, they may have a shot at turning the ban on supersonic travel over land. And if that happens, imagine going from New York to LA in under 2.5 hours. That would be pretty amazing. But if you're anything like me, you're probably wondering, okay, but how does it work? Like, what is that special sauce? This really puzzled me, so I got down to the nitty-gritty. The X-59's most prominent feature is its shape. It has a long and slender fuselage, a canard wing, and a single engine. The most notable features is its nose, and what a nose it is. It takes up almost a third of the long and slender 100-foot fuselage. If you compare that to the Concorde or the Tupolev 144, you'll notice that their noses are much shorter. From what I found, this long, pointy nose is supposed to break the shockwaves that form behind the plane when it goes supersonic. It also has to do with the fuselage's profile and the narrow delta wings, and the fact that the cockpit is smoothly integrated into the fuselage to avoid it disturbing the supersonic airflow that passes around it. And finally, it also has an engine inlet and exhaust system that prevents the engine noise from interacting with the shockwaves. NASA said that these features and aerodynamic geometry reshape the shockwaves to make them weaker by the time they hit the ground, sounding like a soft thud. Now, as an aerospace engineer, I get pretty excited about this prospect. But is this the future of air travel? Another question we have to answer is the efficiency. I assume it should be much more efficient than the Concorde, as it's lighter and more aerodynamic. But we've still yet to see any official numbers from NASA or Skunk Works from Lockheed Martin. I also understand that this is just an experimental plane and a research platform, perhaps a Pathfinder, but there's hardly any room for passengers even if scaled up. My only hope is that everything goes smoothly and NASA and Lockheed can take the next steps and scale this up into a larger scale prototype. The race for the sky is on again, but this time it's not a competition between nations, but a collaboration of innovators. And that has me pretty excited. But there are some fundamental physics problems that we can't lose sight of. For example, most airplanes fly around 0.8 Mach. Meaning 80% the speed of sound, right? Around 550 miles an hour. And that number is very deliberate. Sometimes if you have a tailwind, you could go a little bit faster, but by and large, that's where you get the best fuel burn. And if you wanna keep air travel cheap, that's gonna matter. So I don't think if you're booking a flight on United one day, suddenly there's going to be an option for a supersonic flight and it'll be just a little bit more. It will be considerably more. Because like we mentioned, you're not going to have a 200 passenger 737. You're probably going to have half that or a third of that. And you're going to have higher fuel burn and everything else. But still, this is such an important story because aerospace engineers of tomorrow need something to do. We can't just keep building the same old thing. Ultimately, engineering comes down to a mix of old and proven things and small iterations and 2% improvements, but also radical new rethinking, right? Apple Vision Pro, Tesla Cybertruck. These are examples of throwing out the playbook and starting over. And I'm glad to see that this is happening in aerospace as well. What exactly will become of it is a little bit of an unknown, but you can be sure that I'll cover it. And until there's more news about this, check out this video next. Until next week, I'm Ricky Tuba Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.